Appreciate this crowd out tonight to hear what the Lord has to say through His Word. And we're going to continue on where we left off from this morning. We left off with a message talking about Elijah. It is in 1 Kings, and we're going to be reading 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 1 through 18. It's a lot of verses, but we'll read through them pretty fast and get through it, and then we're going to expound on that scripture and see what the Lord has for us here. But if you have your copy of God's Word, if you please turn to chapter 19, 1 Kings, verse 1, and that's what we'll be reading from. 1 Kings 19, verse 1. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Now, look back at that again. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. We'll talk about that in a minute. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, So let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life, and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die, and said, It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers. And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, an angel touched him, and said unto him, Arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake, baking on the coals, and a cruse of water in his head. And he did eat and drink, and laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again a second time, touched him, and said, Arise and eat, because thy journey, the journey, is too great for thee. And he arose, and he did eat and drink, and he went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights into Horeb, the mount of God. And he came hither unto a cave, and lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said unto him, underline this next sentence in your Bibles, What doest thou here, Elijah? And he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken the covenant. Thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword, and I, even I, only am left. And they seek my life to take it away. And he said, Go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains, and brake in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still, small voice. And it was so when Elijah heard it that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entering of in the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, Underline this again. What doest thou here, Elijah? And he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I, even I, only am left. And they seek my life to take it away. And the Lord said unto him, Go return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when thou comest, anoint Hazael, the king of, over Syria, and Jehu, the son of Nimshi, shalt thou anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat, and Abel-Meholah, shalt thou anoint to be prophet in thy womb. And it shall come to pass that him that escapeth the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapeth from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. Yet I have left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed unto Baal, and every mouth which has not kissed him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the reading of the Scripture. God, we're just asking for you tonight to open it up to us, to reveal what you want us to say in this message, Lord, for our hearts just to be dealt with tonight. Lord, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be in your house and to be able to preach. Lord, we thank you for the good service this morning and for the good spirit tonight. God, we just need a touch from you. We need you to preach this for us. God, we're relying on that so heavily. And you know our heart, Lord. Search us, Lord. Know us. And know that we have to have you. Lord, we're just asking for you tonight to be here in a big way, a mighty way. These things I ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. And so we drop back in after the event for this morning. We're going to recap on that just real quickly. Just stick with me real fast. Probably going to go through it just like a blur.
But this morning we talked about how Elijah would come out and pronounce that the Lord was going to send rain again. And that they had the showdown up on Mount Carmel between him and the prophets of Baal. And all the children of Israel were there as they witnessed this great event, as they had this showdown on Mount Carmel. And then we saw how the children of Israel couldn't even say if they were going to serve God or Baal. When he asked them, which one do you choose, God or Baal? They were quiet. They couldn't say anything because they were embarrassed. They were ashamed. And so we went through and we saw how the prophets of Baal failed miserably at calling on their fake God. He didn't do a thing for them, didn't consume their sacrifice at all. And how Elijah knew that his God was the real God. And he said, if you are the real God, if God Jehovah is the real God, consume the sacrifice. And he did it, and everybody around witnessed it. And remember, they brought in those 12 barrels of water and poured on it even. So it's even a greater miracle. The Lord consumed that whole thing up. And they all fell on their faces and said, the Lord, He is the God. And we remember that. And how they all, it was just a revival that broke out on the land. They slew the prophets of Baal down in the brook Kishon. And then all of a sudden they went out and they saw a little cloud come up that looked like a man's hand. And after the seventh time they saw the cloud and the rain came in abundance. And they had to run and flee to keep from being in the floods. And old Elijah ran out in haste past that chariot into Jezreel. And so this is where we picked up. So just imagine in your mind right now, you've got old King Ahab and his servants, and they're in the chariot, and it's raining, it's pouring, and here they come. Ha! Ha! They're coming into the city, into Jezreel, and they come out to the king's palace and screech to a halt right there in the chariot. And old Ahab gets out, and he walks in, and he washes off the wet off of him, and takes off his raincoat and his galoshes, and he comes into the palace, and there stands that wicked, terrible, horrible Jezebel. And she looks at him and she says, how did it go, honey? I see it's raining. Something good must have happened. You see, she wasn't there. She don't know what happened. But she knows that her man's home and she knows it's raining. So he comes in and tells her all. And if you remember when we started our text, I actually remember that where he said, Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done. He didn't mention what God had done. Elijah didn't do anything except be obedient. He didn't do anything but pray. God did it all. But what did Ahab say? He told Jezebel all that Elijah had done. That little prophet, that woman's caused us so much trouble. He come in here just 3 years ago and said he wasn't going to reign. You never believe what he's done. So he's telling her the whole story. And then he gets to the part where he slew all those prophets of Baal. She's a big Baal worshiper. That was her God. Well, that didn't sit good with her. And she's upset. Like I said this morning, she's the one wearing the breeches in the family, not Ahab. She's calling the shots. And so when he brings out this whole story, and I'm sure he's sitting there feeling all sorry for himself and sulking, coming with his tail between his legs like an old dog, tells this story, and then she gets upset. Verse 2 says, then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. You know what? I don't understand. If she was really wanting to kill him, and she knew where he was because she sent a messenger to him, why didn't she send a mercenary instead of a messenger? Why didn't she send a bounty hunter? Why didn't she send one of those soldiers that the palace had in occupation? Why didn't she send somebody down there, a sniper, something, get rid of Elijah? She didn't. She sent a letter. I don't know if she had a scroll and she maybe got the king's ring and put some wax on it and told the guy, go give that to Elijah. They take him a letter of intent, a death letter, a death threat. Today, if you'd send somebody a letter saying you're going to kill them, you'd be arrested. She sent Elijah a death threat and not somebody to kill him. What's interesting here is she knows that now that this kingdom sees Elijah as the hero. He's the savior of the land. He's brought rain. They've been dying because of the rain not coming for 3 years. And so he's the man. So she can't have him killed right now. If she does, he's going to be a martyr. And that's going to make things worse for her. Because then they'll revolt. The people will revolt if their man gets killed over this. So she's not as stupid as what we think she is. And so she sends a letter of intent for him to die. Now, before I read this next verse, I'm going to tell you right up front, when I was younger, man, not much experience in this world, in this life, I'd read this verse right here, and I would almost be disappointed. I'd be upset at Elijah. I'd be embarrassed of Elijah's actions in this next verse, in verse 3. And I would get upset about it. And I thought, why in the world would a man do that? Do you know what he just did? He just went up on that mountain and through the power of God called down fire and consumed a sacrifice. He saved the entire nation of Israel from idolatry. He slain all those 450 prophets with a sword. He's a man. Why is he running from this woman? And it would upset me. But you know what? I lived a few years since then. And I've got a little more experience now. And I can understand Elijah's thinking. He's not running from this woman. That wasn't it at all. He's not afraid of her. He's not afraid of dying. In fact, he wants to die. So let's look at this a little closer. Now, if you've ever worked yourself up to a big event, perhaps you were in chorus or band in school, and you know how we have these big concerts, and for weeks and weeks and weeks you practice. Maybe it's a competition you're having. And you just practice and practice and practice, and then the big event comes. You have the chorus concert, and all your family comes to hear you. The auditorium's packed out, and you're up there, and you're just nervous, and you get through it, and all is done and over with. And as soon as the curtain falls down, everything's over with, all you want to do is sit down somewhere and cry. I mean, it's just like you've just, everything inside you has been pulled out. You've been excited, working up to this event all this time. And when it's all over with, you just feel like you're empty. And you just feel sick and miserable. Well, you look at Elijah. He's been following God's will. He's done everything God has asked him to do. He's went up there and did all these things. And just, I mean, he's a great man of God. Now, we know from reading our scripture that he's expecting revival in the land of Israel. So imagine Elijah's thoughts as he's sitting there in Jezreel when that messenger comes to the door and he gives him a letter to read. And he picks up the letter and he looks at it. And what do you think he's expected to read right here? Now this is from the king's palace. It's probably got the official scroll and script and wax seal on it. And boy, I bet he's sitting here thinking, when I open this up, this is probably an invitation to come to the palace and preach or something. Because revival's going to break out of the land. They probably turned from all their idols because they saw the power of our God. They saw how God consumed that sacrifice. And they probably want me to come down there and probably have a meal. Probably want to fry me up some chicken and have a meal for the preacher. That's probably what's going on in his mind. So he takes his letter and he opens it up. And it ain't nothing like he was expecting. Nothing at all. It's a death threat. This man's crushed. This man should have been riding around as the center of attraction in the middle of town. The children of Israel should have had him up on their shoulder, running through town with him, saying, Elijah the prophet brought us back to God. Elijah the prophet saved our nation. Elijah the prophet, he's the man. They should have been riding him around and really celebrating. And thanking God for everything that they've done. But did you notice? After the big event on the mountain, it didn't mention the people anymore. They apparently didn't even offer him a ride back to town. He had to run. After the rain came, the prophet was no longer thought of by the people. He's not even around there. All they're concerned about is water. They probably all want to go home and take a bath and get a drink. They're more concerned about the rain than they are the prophet. And I imagine about this point right now, Elijah is at his lowest. He's in his lowest state that he could be in. He's depressed. If he'd had a doctor around there, they would have ordered him up some Prozac to take to get rid of all his depression. So he's sitting around and he gets this letter and he runs out of town, takes off. And like I said, he's not afraid of Jezebel.
Let's keep looking at it. Verse 3. Let's go ahead and read it. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life, and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, and came and sat down under a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die, and said, It's enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers. You see, he wasn't afraid of dying. He wanted to die. What his problem was, he was upset because he didn't feel like he had done his job. He didn't feel like anything that he did mattered. All this work that he went for the Lord, following faithfully, obediently, seeing all those wonderful things, and he thinks he's a failure. Have you ever been in that position right there? Where you've done everything you can do, and you feel like you're a miserable failure. I get that way sometimes. And I'll be honest with you, when I'm working on a sermon, and I put hours and hours and hours of study in it, like that one last Sunday when we talked about the Lord, those 3 hours of darkness, by the time I got done with that sermon, I was sick as a dog. I wanted to go home and bury my head and never look up again. I felt like I was a miserable failure. And I know how Elijah was feeling right here. And all he wanted to do, he said, God, just take me. I want to die. He crawls up under that juniper tree. You notice he left his servant over in Judah, in Beersheba. He wasn't intending on coming back. If he was going to come back, he'd have probably took his servant with him. He leaves him there. He's not intending to come back from this journey he's going on. Verse 5, And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, Arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals and a cruse of water in his head. And he did eat and drink and laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time, touched him and said, Arise and eat, because thy journey is too great for thee. He arose and did eat and drink, and went in the strength of meat 40 days, 40 nights in the Horeb, the Mount of God. Now, let's stop right here. We can stop everything right here and say, Praise God. We can stop right here. We can flip this pulpit upside down. We can walk these pews and swing on the chandeliers tonight. Because our God has seized this man. He's so far out of his will. He's ran from the job. He's asked to be killed. He's sitting there moping and groaning and going, What does God do? He feeds him and nourishes him and takes care of him. He loves him. He takes care of his man. Right now, every person, every Christian, everybody that calls himself a child of God ought to be celebrated for the goodness and the mercy and kindness of the Lord, because he loves us that much. Amen. And we don't deserve it either. Amen. There's not a one of us tonight that deserves to be anywhere except for hell, suffering forever in eternity. But our God loves us so much. He was willing to sacrifice his son for us. And he has that much love and mercy for us. Hallelujah tonight. How he treated this prophet that was so far out of his will. Verse 9. He came thither unto a cave and lodged there. Behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said unto him, What doest thou here, Elijah? That's where we took our title from our text from, is right there. What doest thou here? Now, if you notice, the place he went over in Horeb was the same place that it was Moses went over there. You remember that? He spent a lot of time over there. A lot of things went on. This was God's mountain, the Bible refers to it as. The Mount of God. And so he's going over here. I fully believe he went over there to try to get a little touch from God. To try to get closer to him. You've heard of rededication. I believe he was trying to get a little rededication. And he had went over to this mountain, to these caves. But you know what God says? He said to him, What doest thou here, Elijah? Man, didn't I have a job for you? Didn't I tell you to do some things? What are you doing here? Have you ever been sitting around somewhere you ought not to have been? Have you ever went out and went to a place that you knew you shouldn't have went to? Have you ever been in a position in your life in some kind of sin and you knew you wasn't supposed to be in that sin? And God spoke to you in your head and he said, Hey! What doest thou here? What doest thou here? And you felt that conviction in your heart. That's what's happening to Elijah. He's out of God's will. God's kind of giving a wake-up call. Hey! What doest thou here? God knows why he's there. He's not asking for himself. He's asking Elijah so he can understand himself what he's doing there. And he asked him, what are you doing here? It's just like when he went in the Garden of Eden, and Adam and Eve had already taken of the fruit, and they were still over there in the bushes naked and ashamed. And he said, where are you, Adam? Where are you at? Well, God knew where he was at. He was trying to wake Adam up. What have you done? What have you done? Look what you've done. And that's what he's saying to Elijah. What doest thou here, Elijah? This ain't where you're supposed to be. Verse 10, he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, and thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I, even I, only am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And we spoke of that this morning. He's got the Elijah complex. I'm the only one. He's sitting around just moping. I'm the only one left in all of Israel. Everybody else is forsaken me, God. I did my best. I tried, but I'm a failure. I'm miserable, just like my fathers. I'm terrible. Now, God knows this man. He knows everything about him and everything about his life. He knows that he's just a depressed prophet. You might have remembered when you were in elementary school, a little song that was made up. Everybody hates me. Nobody loves me. Think I'll eat a worm. Elijah's probably up there in the cave, up there on Mount Horeb, singing a song similar to that. I'm just poor, woe is me. So the Lord does something really unexpected here. We look at verse 11. He said, go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And there again, look at that word Lord, all in capital letters, Jehovah. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains and brake in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. So here is Elijah up there in a place he ought not to be, and the Lord commands him to stand and watch something. This was totally unexpected to Elijah. I'd say he never dreamed this was going to happen. And all of a sudden, everything, the wind all around him. And we've been experiencing wind lately. Some of these storms is coming up out of the Gulf and places we hear about, and they name them Island and different names, and I can't think of all of them. But we've experienced some wind, and we've seen the fury of the wind. A lot of places were destroyed from the wind. Well, that's what God's done. He sent this massive, mighty wind enough to break the rocks from the mountain. And this is a spectacle and a sight to behold. And Elijah standing there witnessing all this miracle of God. But the Bible says that God wasn't in that. He wasn't in that. And after the wind and earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. You probably remember the big earthquake here just recently over in Japan, where thousands and thousands of people in that tsunami that came through and killed all those people and everything and destroyed them. Our God is so big and so great that He can move the very axis of the earth. He can crumble and move the entire earth. And so Elijah stand here witnessing all this, but the Bible says the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. The Lord can do anything. He has all the power in His hand. Right now, He can have that sun burst out of a beam of fire if it was His desire to do. And He does this for Elijah. Brings fire. But the Bible says the Lord was not in the fire. But get that last part. And after the fire, a still, small voice. You know, too many times we as Christians are expecting an earthquake. We're expecting a mighty wind. We're expecting fire down from the heavens to lead us and direct us. We're always looking for some miraculous sign. But you know what? The Bible right here plainly told us that God was not in all that. Elijah, you're looking for some big miracle. You're looking for something great. You're looking for this awesome power and all this stuff. I'm not in that. I'm in this still, small voice. You see, our problem today is we're so busy looking for the earthquakes. We're so busy looking for this miraculous sign and all these powers that we fail to hear the still, small voice of God. And when we do hear it, we don't even recognize who it is. We need to be listening. God speaks to us. And it's not always through some great event. Just listen. How do you listen to God? Have you ever heard His voice? His voice is not audible to us. We hear it though. We hear it in our head. Our thoughts that we have in our head when we know right from wrong. when we understand things like that, when He directs our ways, when we see something and we know that's what we're supposed to be doing. That's Him speaking to you. Listen to that voice. You know, people, He'll send people even to have the voice for Him. They may encourage you about something. I remember when I was on the edge, afraid to announce my call to preach. I remember the pastor of that church that I was at. He comes up and he says, "You think it's about time that you started preaching?" How did he know I was laying awake at night, sick over it? How did he know all that? I think God sends people in your lives to kind of help out and be His voice. But we got to listen to those voices. No, not every one of them is not Him. Some people will guide you down the wrong path, so you got to be careful about that. But we need to be listening for that still small voice of God speaking to us. We hear it when we pray. And I'm not going to take off another prayer sermon tonight. We had that one last week. But when we're praying, listen for what God has to say to you. If something keeps bugging you and nagging you, and it's something to do for the Lord, more than likely it's Him trying to tell you something. Listen to that small voice. If you know that you should be doing something, perhaps maybe even going to church or joining a church or going to someone's home to visit them, and you've got that on your mind, and you think, "Well, I need to call so-and-so," but you keep putting it off. That's God's small voice telling you, call that shut-in. Call that person that's in the hospital. Call them. It's Him speaking to you. Listen to that small voice. Don't wait for Him to cause an earthquake. Don't wait until the person dies and they call you on the phone and say, "So-and-so died." Have you ever had that happen to you? I have. Hey, that's a terrible thing. That's horrible. To have something on your heart, on your mind, and you don't take time to do it, and you know you should, and you keep putting it off, and thinking, "Well, it'll be all right for now, it'll be all right for now," and then they die on you. And then somebody calls you and tells you, "Boy, you know what that felt like? That felt like somebody reached in and grabbed your heart and yanked it out because you wasn't listening to God's small voice." So we got to be careful. We need to listen to that voice. We're waiting on the earthquakes. Verse 13 says, "And it was so, when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entry in the cave. Behold, there came a voice unto him and said, 'Again, what doest thou here, Elijah?'" Elijah is awestruck at this time over all these miraculous wonders that God's done. But he's also ashamed. And he wraps his face in his mantle. He wore that mantle. It was the prophet's mantle. And we're going to be speaking on it in a few messages on out when he hooks up with Elisha. And Elisha wants that mantle. But he wraps that thing around his face so that he can't even be seen by God. He don't want God to see him. He don't want to see anything. He's just wanting to hide out. And God comes up to him again. "Elijah, what doest thou here?" Is God speaking to you? Is there something that you're supposed to be doing for Him that you are not doing? Does He keep waking you up at night saying, "Hey, what doest thou here?" Does He have something for you? Have you been turning Him off? Does He keep saying, "What doest thou here?" Listen to that voice. Verse 14, he said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord." Here he goes again. "Been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain the prophets with the sword. And I, even I, only am left, and they seek my life to take it away." Elijah's hard-headed. I'm going to be honest with you. He is hard-headed. God has went through all this stuff to try to show him where he needs to be. And he keeps on. He's still depressed. He's still got all that in his heart, thinking that he's no good. And everybody else is against him. He's the only one left. Well, finally, God's going to have enough of him. Verse 15. "The Lord said unto him, 'Go, return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus. When thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. And Jehu, the son of Nimshi, shalt thou anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat, and Abel-Meholah, shalt thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. And it shall come to pass that him that escaped from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay. And him that escaped from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. Yet I have left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees kings which have not bowed unto Baal, and every mouth which has not kissed him. The Lord's finally saying, Elijah, enough.
Buddy, I've put up with this enough. I've asked you twice now, why are you here? And here you keep going on. Elijah, I've got a job for you. You are a prophet. You need to be doing your job. And I've got a list of things that you need to do. And you're the man to do it. And you're going to get out there and you're going to do it. And he appoints all these things that he has to do. And then he gives him in the little secret that he didn't know about. Oh, and by the way, you're not the only one. There's more than just you. I've got me 7,000 in Israel. It's not bowed down to Baal.
How many of us, again, think that sometimes we're the only one? God has always had people. He always will have. We're not His only one. There's others out there. Just because we're all kind of like-minded, we enjoy the same things, we enjoy the same kind of worship, same kind of songs, it don't mean that all these other people around here are wrong. It don't mean that everybody else around here is sold out. I kind of get that complex a lot of times, thinking everybody's doing all these things that I don't agree with, and they're wrong, and that they don't love God like I love them. We're not the only ones. God can be in that church over there, that church over there, that one over there, and this one back here. They may not be doing the same things we're doing, but if they're preaching the Word of God, then that's what matters. If they're preaching the truth, they're preaching the Word of God. And we're not the only ones. Elijah was not the only one that loved God. He had 7,000 in Israel loving him. I imagine that many of them, every night, would get down their knees and pray that God would save their country and their nation. Friend, God is expecting us to do His job. He's expecting us to be His workers. I know a lot of people don't like to hear that. Nobody wants to have a job put on them that they didn't ask for. Well, when you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you accepted that job. You have become now His spokesperson. He didn't save you just to keep you from hell and just to let you have a merry little life and come up and be with Him in heaven. That was not the whole point. He saved you so you could go out and tell others. You don't have to go to Africa. We've got missionaries that do that. We've got a missionary in Brazil. We got one in Honduras. We got one off the coast of Africa. We support them through our mission money. There's people that do that. He's not asking you to do that. He's asking you to do your mission here, in your community, in your family, in your neighborhood, in your church. He's asking you to do that. If your family is out of the will of God, He's wanting you to help them. He wants you to be a witness to them. He wants you to tell them and urge them to come and get to know Him. It's not the preacher's job. It's not the deacon's job. That is part of our jobs, but it's not solely our responsibilities. It's each individual's responsibility to be the spokesman for God. And you accept Christ as your Savior. It's not that difficult of a thing to let people see Him in your life. There's a little something you can share. Don't make Him cause an earthquake. If you've got a talent that He's gave you, use that talent to sing. It fits your talent. If you've got a talent to teach, use that talent to teach. If you've got a talent to play an instrument, play the instrument. Don't run off and leave God's work undone. Don't make Him say, hey, what doest thou here? Because your job is over there. Essentially, that's what He's telling Elijah. See, Elijah wasn't afraid of Jezebel. He wasn't afraid of Ahab. He was afraid of failure. And we all are. Through the power of God, He will see us through it. Charlotte, would you come up and play the piano? Some invitation song? I appreciate your good attention tonight. And I pray that the Lord has gave us something to think about and to dwell on. I don't know your hearts. I don't know your minds. I don't know what you're thinking right now. It doesn't matter to me, but God does.
He knows what your job is, and you know what your job is. So let's stand tonight as she plays, and I want to pray with you. And as I'm praying, if there's one here with a need, I'm going to ask you to come to this altar tonight and lay that need down at the altar. If it's something that you need to work out with God, come and work it out with Him on this altar tonight as we pray. Father, we thank You so much for this opportunity to be here tonight. Lord, we thank You for the Scripture and for what it means. We thank You for sending those to work on Your behalf. God, I thank You for the opportunities that You present for us. Lord, most of all, we thank You for the salvation You freely gave us. God, I pray that we don't take it for granted. I pray that we're doing our jobs. Lord, I pray that we don't have to sit around and have to hear You say, "What doest thou here?" God, if there's one in this building tonight that knows that they need to come down and make things right, I pray that You urge them to do that. Lord, I'm praying if there's one here, Lord, convict that heart. Send them down. Lord, if not here, later on, Lord, stay with them. These things we ask in the precious name of Jesus. And amen.